Last week, I did a video about the benefits of shadow work, and in this video, I wanted to talk about some techniques that you can start to use to begin your shadow work process. But before we dive in, hi, I'm Sandra from MysteryWitchSchool.com. If you're new to the channel and you want to know more about Wicca and witchcraft, hit the subscribe button and the notification bell so that you don't miss any videos. And if you are interested in learning Wicca in a group of like-minded people in an online community, then have a look at the Mystery Witch School 101 Academy. It's a 12-month experience of actually practicing Wicca and incorporating the Wiccan practices in your daily life so that you can live a life of more joy, more confidence, and more empowerment and creativity. The link to that is in the description field below this video. Shadow work is important part of any self-development process, spiritual work, and it is something that is very important for me because it has totally changed my life, and it's something I incorporate in the Mystery Witch School because it is so important. This shadow work is the foundation of our joy. It's the foundation of our happiness, and it is also the foundation of our spiritual practice, because what happens with shadow work is that we learn who we truly are, and we learn to stop judging ourselves. And when we stop judging ourselves, we stop judging everyone else, which is good. When we start to accept ourselves and love ourselves, we can be more accepting and loving to others as well. Whatever we're feeling inside ourselves, whether we're aware of it or not aware of it, we are projecting out into the world. And that is a magical process that can often attract back to us what it is that we're projecting out. And if when projecting stuff out that isn't very good, unhelpful, harmful, then we're going to get more of that coming back at us, and that's just not fun at all. So shadow work itself is hard, it's difficult, it's challenging, it's not a walk in the park, but it is well worth the energy and time spent with it, because not doing it just leaves you in a state of continuous anxiety and not really connecting to your true being. So the first way that you can start to do this is to learn to connect to your observing self, or become aware of your observing self. Your observing self is that part of you that observes everything that's going on within you and also without of you or outside of you. It's that part of you that can observe the fact that your body is experiencing pain. It's that part of you that observes your emotions, the part of you that observes your thoughts, but it observes them without getting identified with them, without being attached to them, and without reacting to them. So this is where it gets tricky, because we have the ego self, which is the part of ourself that identifies with everything and thinks it is these things. And then we have the observing self, which is closer to our true spiritual self, that doesn't get involved. It just observes. And we have to learn to differentiate between the two. So the way to start doing that is to go somewhere in nature or somewhere quiet where you won't be disturbed. You can start meditation or just quiet the mind and ask yourself the question, who am I? Who am I? Who am I? Take notice of your body and any physical sensations that you have in your body. And notice that you can observe them. If you're feeling an itch, say that to yourself. My body is experiencing an itch. I'm observing this. Therefore, if I can observe this, I am not it. And then you say to yourself, I am not my body. Now, anyone who's done any Eastern practices probably knows this as the Advaita Vedanta practice, where you're trying to really get in touch with who you truly are, and detaching yourself from your thoughts, feelings, and emotions in order to do so. So when you can observe something, you're not it, because the true you cannot observe itself. So that's why you're here experiencing life, so that you can observe life and experience what it's like to be conscious. But you can't actually, the observing self can't experience itself. It can only experience what it's experiencing, or what the body is experiencing, what the mind is experiencing. So when you learn that you are not your body, it helps you be able to detach yourself from identifying with your body as being who you are. The next thing you want to observe is how you're feeling emotionally. Do you feel a sense of anxiety, a sense of fear, joy, happiness? And understand that if you can observe these feelings, these emotions, then you are not those emotions either. And that your observing self, when you're observing, after you practice this for any length of time, when you're observing these feelings, the feelings actually lose their energy, they lose their effect, and you don't feel them so strongly, or you don't feel them at all. The next thing is to do the same with your thoughts. Notice what you're thinking. You can watch your thoughts. They can play out in front of you like you're watching a movie. You can watch them jump from tree to tree to tree, from thought to thought to thought. And when you can watch that, you realize you're not your thoughts either. And this is good news because it means that you're none of these things that are actually causing you pain and grief most of the time, a lot of the time. Because it's our thoughts and our feelings and our emotions that make life difficult for us. And when we can start observing them, then we can start changing them. But the first thing you've got to do first is observe them and realize that that part of yourself is observing them isn't actually those things. So this brings us to the second technique, which is detachment. So when you realize that you have an observing self who's observing your body and your feelings and your thoughts, you can start to then ask yourself, well, what is thinking these thoughts? What is feeling these feelings? So if you're feeling a little bit of anxiety, you can go, well, what is feeling the anxiety then? What is feeling the anxiety? It's not your observing self because you're watching the anxiety. So what is feeling your anxiety? And you realize it's your ego. It's a part of you that's saying, this isn't safe, this isn't safe, this isn't safe. Or that ego might be going, those people are dangerous, those people are dangerous, those people are dangerous. Now, they may very well be dangerous or they may not be dangerous. A lot of the time, the ego's not correct. It's often seeing the illusory world and thinking it's real. But the fact that you're able to detach yourself and go, well, what is thinking these thoughts? What is feeling these feelings? Allows you to go, well, hang on. There's a part of me that can actually not get caught up in identifying with these things. And that makes life easier. So once you're able to detach yourself and look at your thoughts, feelings, and emotions, you can then start to have a conversation with that part of you that is experiencing the feelings, for example. So you can start to learn to work with various different techniques of having a conversation between your observing self and your ego self. So you can ask your ego, what is not safe about this situation? The ego is always about safety. Whether you're feeling anger, whether you're feeling fear, whether you're feeling sadness, grief, whatever you're feeling, the fear is always the number one thing that the ego is alerting you to. When you're having a conversation with your ego, you can then start to identify from a discernment point of view whether something is actually dangerous or not in reality. Most of the time, it's not. Most of the time, the ego is just running a program that it's learned, that you've programmed it with, and that other people have programmed it with when you were in your childhood, and it's just running the same program over and over again. And when you can start having a conversation with your ego, and you can see your ego is actually being something that isn't actually you, it's a part of you, but it's not actually you, and you don't take it with you when you die either. It gets left behind too. Or disintegrates over a little bit of time after you die, then you'll realize that this part of you, this observing self, this is actually your consciousness. And you stop being so identified with everything that's going on. The ego is the thing that identifies. The ego is the thing that's telling you you're this or you're that or you're not this or you're not that. The observing self isn't running that program. It's observing it. So then there's a lot of techniques you can use to start to change the program. So conversing with the ego, finding out what the ego is saying to you. You can have a conversation to say, well, okay, what if I can do this action? If it's telling you it's not safe to do something, what if I can do this and be safe at the same time? You can use EFT, emotional freedom technique, which is one of the techniques I use. You can use Gestalt, you could use hypnotherapy, or any of the modalities that help you reprogram the subconscious mind. so that you can talk to the ego and then help change it so that it's got a more realistic view of the world. And then it becomes a tool for you to use. Your observing self, your true self, can then utilize the ego when it's programmed properly to help keep you safe and to do the things that you need to do and express yourself in the world the way you need to express yourself in the world in order to do what you came here to do. So when your ego and your higher self are aligned, that's when you really are fulfilling your purpose here. When they're not aligned, when they're at odds with each other, which most for pretty much all of us, it is, and it's the work that we do when we're here is to try to line them up, then that's where we end up with roadblocks and not being able to do the things that we know that we came here to do. So shadow work is a really important aspect of trying to bring meaning into our life and actually align us with our purpose for being here in the first place. And one of our purposes of being here is to bring the ego and the true self into alignment. And this is how you start doing it. So try that. Let me know in the comments field how you go with asking yourself those questions and what you observe and what your ego may even tell you, because that is the first step towards doing the shadow work. I work with people one-to-one to do shadow work. So if you are interested in doing some work with me on your shadow or ego self to help align it with your true self, then do flick me an email. It's sandra@mysterywitchschool.com. And just give me a little bit of an idea of what it is that you're looking for. And then we can set up a meeting over Zoom. And I usually give a free clarity session, so I'll let you know how you can get one of those when you email me. If you like the video, hit the like button, share it with your friends. Don't forget to subscribe. I'm Sandra from mysterywitchschool.com. Blessed be.